And welcome into another edition of It's Talladega. In case you're tuning in for the first time, this program is designed to talk about all the positive things going on in Talladega, a city that's open for business. And we're very honored today to have a lady, a longtime resident of Talladega, Miss Donna Rowe. And she likes to travel, her and her husband, and they like to ride motorcycles. They live on a farm or have a farm, a lot of land. She's raised on a farm, so I guess you could say she is a country girl. But Miss Donna Rowe, most definitely country girl. She's gets up tours periodically, and we're going to be talking about an upcoming tour that she's got, and you might be interested in contacting her and be a part of this tour. Miss Donna Rowe, welcome to our program.
I'm glad to be here.
We had Miss Rowe on our Sunday night program some time back, and we were sort of short of time, and I promised her I would bring her back when we have more time to talk about more things, and that's what we're going to do today. Miss Rowe was born in Anniston, Alabama, moved to Cleburne County near Heflin as a toddler, and her father bought a farm, and I understand they have her and her mother together around 600 acres in that area.
Yes, sir.
That's a lot of grass to cut with a push lawnmower.
Oh, yeah, it is. No, we didn't have a push lawnmower, though. You know, my dad was into
had a swing
having...
blade.
No, he had...
tractors?
Tractors and lawnmowers and farm, you know, all that good stuff.
So you know about baling hay and...
Oh, my goodness, yes.
Using the disc to plow with.
And yeah, I've disc and I've baled hay and I've rolled hay.
Slopped the hogs and fed the chickens.
Yeah, definitely.
Milked the cows.
I have milked cows.
I tried once.
And what I remember of it is it was always cold. My grandmother lived with us for many years and she had milk cows. But one of them knocked her over and hurt her one day.
Kicked her
and knocked her over by accident, but it hurt her, and my dad got rid of the milk cows. And then we had a milkman, believe it or not, out in the country. We had a milkman for many years.
We had one of those that came around Bemis in our days.
Mm-hmm.
Bring around in
the glass jugs.
Glass jugs at that time. You put out a list of what you wanted, and he'd come by and
come in and put it in the refrigerator, yeah.
But
never had the house
tried,
locked.
I tried. We didn't either. I tried milking one time, and I couldn't. There's a method of that getting it to flow properly.
I could do it. I don't know if I could do it now, but when I was about 7 or 8 years old, you know, I could milk a cow.
You were born, like I said, born on a farm. Had a lot of experience as a toddler on the farm.
Oh,
of course,
yes.
The things that we went through with those, and I don't remember all those old timey days. We've never had outdoor facilities. We've always been fortunate through the years to have indoor plumbing,
well,
water in the house. But
when Mother and Daddy moved to Cleburne County, I have to kind of tell you the story. My dad had a very good friend called Jim Connell, and he had an uncle, Jimmy, that owned a farm in Cleburne County, and he got Daddy one day, and they went rabbit hunting or quail hunting. I can't remember which one it was, but my dad came home and told my mother in a very nice little three-bedroom, two-bath home there, you know, post-war little brand new little home, that he bought a farm and they were moving to Cleburne County. And the house did not have indoor plumbing when they moved in it. They put it in there, but when they moved, it didn't. And everybody in the neighborhood, mother says that they all gave her 3 months and she'd be back. You know, that she would leave and come back, but that was over 50 years ago, so she's still there. She's still there.
I understand your mother's 90 years
old. She's 90 years old.
That's great.
90
still,
years
still
old.
Pretty good health?
Yes, very good health.
Through the years, you went to, where did you go, University of?
I went to Auburn University.
Auburn University.
And I have a degree in housing and design, and I worked as an interior designer for many years. And I kind of got tired of it. I don't know, you just, and I told my mother, and she says, well, figure out something, go back to school. So I went to Jacksonville and got my education certification, and then AIDB hired me, working with the elderly blind. A lot of what I did was working with them in their kitchens and things to make things safe and for them be able to do things. And then I went to the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa and got my master's in counseling.
I understand you was with a band. 7 years and had a major at 4 years. Head major at 2 years.
Yeah, I was, you know, in a small town like Heflin, when you get good enough to play, it didn't matter that I wasn't even in high school yet. I was in the sixth grade, but we marched because they needed the people.
Needed the cheerleaders,
they
the majorettes.
They needed us, you know, so I marched for 7 years.
What did you play in the band?
I played clarinet. And then I became a majorette, and I was a majorette for 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, and I was head majorette for 2 years. And I remember we used to come when they opened up the racetrack. You know, all the bands in the area used to come every race. You know, I don't think they don't do that anymore, all the bands, but, you know, they'd just be 50 high school bands there, you know, and we used to come every time. It was always hot.
Your dad was a train collector.
He collected Lionel trains. He was in the trucking business for many years, but
according
he collected
to this,
Lionel
over trains. 1,300 pieces of
it's over 1,300 pieces that I inherited when he passed away.
And you still have it?
Still have it, yeah.
You need a house just for the trains.
You do.
Tracks.
It covers half a house.
Yeah. I remember all those old, they were made out of, I guess, tin. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, everything made out of plastic.
Well, but you know, Lionel, you know, a lot of it's made out of tin. Some of it is made out of plastic. But it, you know, he collected specifically, mostly what they call post-war, which is 1946 to about 1980. You know, that's what he collected. He had some from what they call pre-war, which is pre-World War II. They didn't make any during the war. You know, Lionel retooled the factories and made things for the Army. You know, and they didn't make any trains during World War II. So that's why they categorize them as pre-war and post-war, because certain trains were made in certain years.
During Auburn, when you went to university, you was received the honor of Woman of Substance and Integrity mm-hmm. by the Auburn University School of Consumer Affairs in 2002.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. On the National Board of Rehabilitation Association, President of State Chapter of AER. You have quite a resume of things you've done through the years.
I've tried. You know, the Auburn thing was kind of a shock. They called me and asked me to come down and the only time I guess I've ever been wined and dined, you know, we had a cocktails and we had a party and they fed us lunch and they did, you know, and kind of nice to be kind of wined and dined.
I had to wear all those fancy clothes.
I had to get
evening
cocktail dresses. Yes, I did.
I enjoy, as mayor of the town, I enjoy going to different functions, but I just almost flat refuse to wear that monkey suit. Those black tucks and tails.
But men always look so handsome in them.
If I can't look handsome in a regular black tie affair or suit, then I'm not going. Well, I guess I would if I had to, but I never have cared for those black tails and cummerbund, yeah, wrap around your waist and all that good stuff. But speaking of dressing up, I know through the years, and we'll get off on your tours, you was a hostess or whatever at Eufaula?
I've been a hostess for the pilgrimage in Eufaula. It's similar to the one that Talladega has.
I believe we have a picture of Mr. Engineer if we can show.
There you are. One story that's kind of funny about that, I think it was that same day because I got this dress on and my friend says, here, get in front of the azaleas, let me take your picture. So she took it. And I started walking up the street and I had to go about 7 or 8 blocks to the house where I was working. And, you know, when you get that dress on, it's so hard to get in a car till you just rather walk.
Can you get that on by yourself?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. But I'm walking down the street, and all of a sudden I hear, ma'am, ma'am, please stop, stop, ma'am, stop. Then I finally realized that they were talking to me. And I stopped and turned around, and there was this couple from Indiana. And they got out of the car and stood me over in front of one of the houses and took my picture because I was such a Southern belle walking up the street.
I remember when Mayor and I were going together back in 53, 54, back in those, they had the big hoop skirts with the crinolines.
Yeah, in the 50s, they had the hoop skirts and crinolines.
And they wear those things to school, and you couldn't get in and hardly get into a car.
No, you can't. You can't. It's just, it's very hard. You'd rather just walk, you know.
Those were days out of the gone with the wind days and those big hoop skirts, big dresses.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. How did you wind up getting involved with the pilgrimage in Eufaula?
A friend of mine, a very good friend of mine, lives down there. And I just love those old homes, you know. A lot of the homes down there are what's considered antebellum. Talladega has a few antebellum homes, or homes built before the war.
Right.
And then we have a lot that were built right after the war. But, You know, they're just beautiful. I love them. I guess Gone with the Wind started it all. My mother took me to the Alabama Theater when I was a little girl to see Gone with the Wind, so that kind of started it all.
My mother-in-law, the late Nell Chandler, loved Gone with the Wind movie. And we bought, she'd see it on TV sometime. We finally bought her a DVD. Mm-hmm. And she'd play, I bet she played the thing 900 times. She'd just sit and watch it and watch it.
I get in moods and I'll play it every once in a while, but I don't play it over and over again. But I'll get in the mood where I need to see it again and I'll watch it.
You're married to Greg.
I'm married to Greg.
Y'all have two children, three children?
No, one stepson, Derek. And we've had him, and he lived with us, and he went to school in Talladega and graduated from Talladega High School, then went to Jacksonville State, and he's got a real good job now working for a computer company called CGI, and they do computer programs for banks and things, and they even worked on the computer program for the government for Obamacare. When it wasn't working,
right?
They hired his computer company to figure out what was wrong and fix it.
That's great. So, you, through the years, how long have you been a motorcycle enthusiast? When you married Greg?
When I married Greg. Of course, my dad.
There we go.
My dad had a motorcycle before I was ever born. He had an Indian chief from the early 40s, you know, so they used to ride all the time.
Do y'all, there's another picture of where this made in.
That's at the Dragon. It's Deal's Gap. It's a road.
Where's Deal's Gap?
It's in North Carolina.
Okay.
And there's a road there that's like, there's 144 curves in 11 miles or something, and it's called the Dragon, the Tail of the Dragon.
Okay.
And there's a, right in behind where this picture was taken, there's a tree back over there. And it's hanging full of motorcycle parts, and that's the Tree of Shame if you crashed on the Dragon. And somebody gets killed there about every year, somebody does. But that's our friend, that's Johnny and Sandra, and they like to ride, so we're up in the mountains riding.
Do you travel a lot on the motorcycle?
Not as much as we did.
There's a picture of the mountain.
Yeah, there's mountains. That's from the top of the Chiricahua Skyway, which is my favorite ride. It's a beautiful, beautiful ride, even in a car if you're ever up there. Find the Chiricahua Parkway. And it goes up over a mile high. I think it's like 5,600 feet or something, the sign says, and it's just absolutely beautiful up there.
I've always had a lot of respect for Harley-Davidson or motorcycle, but I've never had enough backbone to crawl on one and try to ride it. I respect those. They'll lay you down and stomp on you if you don't want to.
Oh, they will, but we're the weird ones in the group around here because we have a BMW. Greg has people will literally walk up to it and say, this is the Bond bike. And he goes, yeah, because it was that particular bike, the 1200C Montana, was used in Tomorrow Never Dies, one of the James Bond movies.
Right.
And it jumps a helicopter in it. And it's kind of famous for being in a James Bond movie. So that's the
what year model is that?
It's about 2001, 2002, something like that.
And you travel a lot on it?
We do.
Do you have a sidecar or you just
No, I wish we did, you know. The next trip we've been planning is we want to go to New Orleans and then take the River Road, which is supposed to be a very good motorcycle trail to follow from up the river from New Orleans to Baton Rouge. And then there's places you stop along and see, you know, the old homes and things like that. You can stop and see a lot of that on the way, so we want to do that.
When you're traveling on the motorcycle, everybody sitting in the living room going, well, ask her. Where do you stay at night? Do you have a tent?
In hotels. No.
Oh,
no.
So
I'm
you don't
not
rough it
person.
Then?
No, I'm not, I don't rough.
You're a country girl, but you don't sleep on the ground.
No, I like a room service. You know, I grew up in the country.
And the other
we
question?
Worked hard, you know, but,
and the other
but
question,
I like room service.
The other question is, where do you keep your spare tire?
You don't. You just have to, if you blow a tire, you've got to find a motorcycle shop that
but what if
sells
you,
tires.
100 miles up in the mountain.
You have to get somebody to come and just tow you in, just
I've
like
always,
a car.
I've always had a horror about riding one, a bicycle, motorcycle, not a bicycle, but I wondered how you guys always maneuvered get out somewhere and the thing tears up on you, tire goes flat.
Oh, we had a friend who blew a tire up around Fort Payne, and he had to, you know, get towed in and bought a tire somewhere, and they put the new tire on it and everything, but he had to do it, you know. You can't move that motorcycle on one wheel, mm-hmm. you know. It's got to be picked up and towed.
Let's get into the tour business. How did you get interested in tourism?
Well, I guess it all started with movies because, you know, you see Gone with the Wind, and then you want to see all the homes here in the South. And the best place to do that is Natchez, Mississippi. Natchez, Mississippi literally has, in 1861, when the Civil War began, there were more millionaires in the city of Natchez, Mississippi than lived in New York, Chicago, and what was the other city they said? Combined. New York, Chicago, and Philadelphia combined. There were more millionaires there. And the whole city is just like it's just stopped in time almost. You know, they have laws against defacing anything. And
gotta keep it just like it was originally.
Just like it was. If you do work to it, it has to be put back just
well,
like
Well, we
it
have
was.
A historical district in Talladega. The mm-hmm. same thing applies.
Same thing applies,
We have
yeah.
a historical committee, and they want to make sure that we preserve mm-hmm. our history.
But that, when I was a little girl, my dad used to, almost every year we would go to Natchez, and we would go to New Orleans, and we would go up into the mountains. And my favorite place in the mountains is the Biltmore House. And if you've never been there,
yeah.
you need to go. I mean, it is a fabulous thing. And the thing that I see is I went there. I guess I was 10 years old the first time I went there. You know, and you just went you parked at the front door, literally, and you toured a few of the rooms on the bottom floor. And then my dad went to what was called then the calf barn. That's why he wanted to go, because they had these beautiful Jersey dairy cattle and these calves, and he just loved that. Well, the calf barn isn't even there anymore. They turned it into a winery, you know, but it has changed so much through the years, and they have built more on and on and on. You know, they've built and opened up so much more. And it's the largest privately owned residence in the United States. It's still in private hands. The government does not own it.
Let's talk about tourism. How many tours have you led, or I don't know what would be the word to say lead?
One, two, three. About five or six. This will be the sixth one, I think.
I know you've been into England.
I've been to England about 8 or 9 times now, I think. It started in the tourist business. A friend of my parents, they had a business, and they took bus tours all around the United States and all up in Canada. And when I got into college, if they had one when I was out of school, I got a free passage and everything for working. And I was kind of the gopher. I hauled luggage, I took people's snacks, just anything and everything that needed to be done, I did it. But I got a free trip out of it. And I went all over Canada and all over the Western United States and just everywhere, you know, all around. I've been to all the states now except Alaska, and we've got to hit Alaska sometime.
We had a lot of Canadians at our race this couple of weeks ago.
Canada's just beautiful.
Yeah, they
fly, absolutely beautiful.
They drive in, they fly into a certain area to meet their friends like Michigan or wherever,
mm-hmm.
and then they drive down.
And they drive
and
down.
And we were impressed. They were very, very impressed with our area here and enjoyed coming to the race.
One of the most beautiful cities in the world is Victoria, Canada, which is on Vancouver Island. You know, you get Seattle and the Puget Sound, and then there's Vancouver, Canada. And then there's a little island, and the city of Victoria is on it. And Victoria is just absolutely a beautiful, beautiful city. They have these huge street lights everywhere, up every street, and they have these, baskets of flowers that are about 5 or 6 feet across, and they're hanging. And they keep them just perfect, and these beautiful flowers are just everywhere. They have little people who come by every morning, and you'll see them up there, and they'll be watering the flowers in the hanging baskets. So just beautiful city, beautiful city.
What about, have you had any overseas trips other than England?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. I've, let me see.
Been into Germany?
Or? I have been to Germany. I've been to some places that aren't even there anymore. I've been to Yugoslavia, which isn't even a country anymore. You know, and that's kind of weird to me that things happen, you know, that change things so much. And a friend of mine and I were talking one day about two quotes that have seriously changed the world. And that was, I am a Berliner. You know, John Kennedy said that about Berlin. And then Ronald Reagan said, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Yeah.
And that completely changed the world, you know, because East Germany and West Germany doesn't exist anymore. When I went to Berlin, you know, you got on a train in West Germany somewhere, and you took that train into East Berlin, and that was the only way you could get there. You couldn't go across country, but you go into West Berlin, and then when you toured, you got back on that train, and you rode back out of East Germany, back into West Germany.
When I was stationed in Germany, in Munich, we went on a tour to Berlin.
Mm-hmm. Munich is beautiful.
We went through Checkpoint Charlie at that time. And we had our Western tour guide, but when we got to Checkpoint Charlie, he had to get off the bus. They won't let him go inside East Germany, East Berlin.
You had to get another one.
So we had an East Berliner, East German girl, a guy, took us on in and toured us around. And then I've not been back since the wall's been torn down. Mm-hmm. That was when the wall was still up.
Well, I haven't either, and I want to do that.
Beautiful country.
Beautiful. Germany is just one big postcard.
Let's talk about your trip that you got upcoming.
Trip that I'm taking next year is going mostly to France, but it starts out in London, and it's going to Stonehenge and Portsmouth. Portsmouth was the starting point for D-Day, and a lot of people don't realize that. All of the soldiers, they funneled them down through England, and a gentleman who lived here in Talladega, Mr. Chris Joyner, told me one time that he'd been on one of those boats for about a month with like 5,000 men crammed on one little boat that held about 300 people. He said he'd have gone anywhere to get off that boat.
Mr. Chris Joyner was in Beamiston, worked at Beamiston for years, lived down behind the church.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, his daughter still lives there.
Still lives down there.
Brenda, Miss Brenda.
And the first time I went, we're going to London, and then we're going to Stonehenge, which is a fascinating, fascinating place because of just its age. You know, it's like 5,000 years old. And then we're going to Portsmouth and catching the ferry across to the D-Day beaches and going to tour Arromanche, which is where they set up all of the temporary docks and everything for everybody to land carrying supplies, and go into Omaha Beach and Utah Beach and Point Du Hoc, and going to the American Cemetery. And that's a very, very moving thing.
This will be June the 11th.
Yes.
Through June the 20th, maybe?
About
a week right
out. You know, it's going to be 12 days.
12 days,
or 13
2 weeks
days.
Ago, yeah.
That's the tentative date they've given me. They said it could change a day or two, kind of depending on what they get set up, but that's basically it. But D-Day is just a fascinating experience, and I think I had seen the old movie The Longest Day. I remember seeing that, but after I toured the D-Day beaches, you know, Saving Private Ryan came out. And that's one of the few movies I ever saw that I had nightmares about, and I did. That opening montage, you know. And people like Mr. Joyner, you know, he told me, I tried to find an apple orchard when we were there, because he said when they finally made it up off the beaches and out, that they found an apple orchard, and there were apples on the trees, and they ate apples and slept on the ground that night. And I looked for an apple orchard, but I couldn't find one.
We owe a debt of gratitude to our folks through the years who fought so hard to make sure that we have freedom. And of course, today's war, they fight, has nothing to do like they used to do. It used to be ground pounders and the M1 rifle or whatever you had to fight with. Now they go in and bum you and, and drop the, you know, it's changed quite drastically.
Shock and awe, yeah. They call it. Well, the cemetery there, it's interesting because the French government gave that property to the United States, and that's literally belongs to the United States. The American cemetery there, and there are thousands of soldiers were buried there from that died from June the 6th through June the 8th. There is a section that's called the Unknowns. That, you know, in the 40s, they just didn't have what we have now in the way of DNA testing to find out who somebody is. And then there's a section for Medal of Honor winners. But it is just an absolutely beautiful place, and you know, and it's wonderful.
We're going to be visiting some palaces while you're there,
and going to the Loire Valley and two of the largest castles in Europe. We're going to Chenonceaux, which is a very unusual place because it starts out on the side of the Cher River, and instead of just building out that way, they built over the river. And it's literally, the chateau is built over the river. The river runs underneath the house. And that's very peculiar.
I guess you could just sit in your living room and fish, couldn't you?
You could.
Cut a hole in the floor and...
You stick it out the window and you're over the river. You know, when that, the last time I was there, you know, there were some little boats going underneath and we watched them go underneath the house. Little small boats, and they were going under the house. You know, it was funny. And then going to Chambeau, which is a huge house, and it's called the House of Chimneys because it's got about 200 chimneys to it. And they're just everywhere. They're sticking all over the top. It's very unusual.
It'd be rough having to tote coal and firewood.
Oh, definitely. But if you were that rich, you know, you just had somebody do it for you.
If you've tuned in, we're fixing to tune you out. We've been talking with Ms. Donna Rowe, excuse me, on It's Talladega. The program will run 3 or 4 times during the week. And we appreciate Ms. Donna Rowe being with us, talking about her upcoming tour and her past. Let's look in this camera right here, Ms. Rowe, and give the folks how they can contact you if they want to go on this trip.
My phone number is 256-362-8279. Just give me a call and I'll send you all the information. The tour is going to London, like I said, to D-Day beaches, Paris, and then we're going to the south of France in Monaco. So that's a place I've not been, is the south of France along the Mediterranean, which I think would be just absolutely a beautiful, beautiful trip. And it'll be a very educational trip too, I think.
I know they're asking, well, how much is this going to cost me?
Can it
be financed?
It can be financed. And the company now, if you sign up, you can pay by the month. They will figure out how much you owe per month and pay in advance for the trip and pay for it and not have to come up with $5,000 in one whack, you know, which is what you'd have to do. And that seems like a lot of money, but it covers basically everything.
Plane
tickets, meals. Hotel rooms, meals, your transportation, your fees, entrance fees into all these places. It basically, once you've paid that, you just need a little spending money. You know, like you want some lunch, or if you want to buy a.
I hate to cut you off, but we're fixing to get cut out.
I
didn't have time to tell about her homemade jelly. We'll have to do another program sometime. How she makes this homemade jelly. Got to go, folks. See you next time for another edition of It's Talladega. Thanks for tuning in.